And mostly it comes down to lots of people being able to use your website from anywhere in the world. You've got to take into account that all the people that use your website are different. They're different in languages. They're different in terms of how they expect to use the interface. They're different in terms of the way they keep time, it's different in time zones. And today, what I'm going to be talking about is the ways in which you can build your site to take care of this, to deal with this, and to provide a good user interface for people who don't manage any function, etc. So, I'm going to be talking about five topics. The first one is going to be data type, because it's surprisingly hard. Second one is going to be localization and internationalization, because people want to see things in their own language. People want to see things in a way that makes sense to them. Third thing I'm going to be talking about is address handling, because every country in the world has got its own postal system and they do not conform. Another thing I'm going to talk about today is going to be UTF-8 and carrier sets in general, because it's hard. It's not very hard. So, data type keeping. This has been fairly close to my heart today, because my client brought me in order to manage a test. And recently, what happened was the clocks went back. And when the clocks go back, if you've got daytime code and you're not dealing properly with time zones, it will break. So that was no fun. So, daytime objects. I'm going to begin with. I'm going to start with the database. Always store things in the database in UTC. It is the one true time zone. I can't express how much time I've been through to come to this conclusion. Done. No local time zone, it's not global slash London. Just put it in UTC. That's story, that's easy. On the daytime level, there are a few simple rules that I've got to make sure that the data path works. The first thing is, whenever you're comparing some daytime objects, put them in the same time zone. It sounds obvious, but you'd be surprised. I cannot count how many bugs I fix with that. Particularly over the period between the clocks going forward and the clocks going back, you will not believe just how many bugs have been introduced by doing that. And it's hard to notice when everything's suddenly an hour out. You just don't know why. Why is this an hour out? Why? Does it make any sense? Well, it does. For half a period. Second thing is, generation objects in daytime are not perfect, to say the least. So when you are comparing objects and you get back nice generation objects, unfortunately, it's kind of hard to say how many seconds are in time. You can say how many seconds are in January, you can work it out. Well, you can in time, but more about the second. It's hard to say this is a period of 1 month, how many seconds will it have? It's hard, because we know what we're talking about. We just can't do it. Things are complicated further by the fact that there is a thing called heap seconds. And I don't know how many people can show of hands have heard of heap seconds. Which is why, again, you should be using UTC. day. Don't use daytime today, because that doesn't get time. Instead, you have to use quite a long script where you use your daytime now. Set time zone, truncate to today. If my slides are up, then you'll see how you make your sense of the set. I'm going to stop talking about that easy. Yes, daytimes are hard. I'm just checking my time. Okay, so we've got a list of character sets next. Character sets are not that hard, provided you can make certain rules about data, which is to say, tell people what data you use. On the web, this is a bit different, because people don't do that. People don't give you the information on your data. And, frankly, in the web, compared to greater application, not malicious intent, because they are malicious. So, it can start with things like adding the end type attribute to all the four tags. You can start with that. That will instruct the browser or the character set to send things in. It doesn't necessarily mean you get them, that's what happens. There is, I forget the name, but there is this fantastic system someone designed that relies on in the form fields. And through, I think, 8 in the form fields, you can determine when the data hits your browser what character set the browser submitted before it. Because they worked it out, there is only, I think, 3-8 characters. You can work out something like 200 different character sets, which is impressive.
Yeah.
And knowing that, you can decode that data in order. In short, demand UTF-8 everywhere. There are character sets working on some of UTF-16. I don't mind. I like UTF-8 and there are not all of your users are going to be using text and Chinese and Japanese, so I'm going high value. So optimize for the best user, which is to say stick stuff in UTF-8. That's the first rule. The second rule is decode data on the way. The encode module is a fantastic module. And you have to understand the difference in built between byte string and character string. Byte strings are just chunks of bytes. And that's all. Character strings, once you have taken a string and made it into a character string, Perl can deal with things on the character string. But when you're doing uppercase, whereas bytes, if you've got a byte script, your data is not exactly 1 byte per time, and it gets very confusing results. Decode data on the way through the encode decode function. So encode. This forces Perl to parse the character set that you've chosen and turn that into a character set. On the way in, always a decode. And on the way out, there's an encode. You've got to specify not only what format your data's coming in, but what format your data's going out. And again, UTF-8 is not a bad default for that. Personally, I quite like UTF-8. It's a standard. Once you've got the data in, and you've got character strings, everything will take you. You don't need to think about it. That's the gist of character. And Mike Whitaker has got a talk in Lecture 32, just after that. And he's going into a lot of depth about character set mapping, and I would recommend it's important for plus to do that. That's all I'm concerned about, since they are pretty simple. And go on the way in, and go on the way out. Sorry, go on the way in, and go on the way out. It's a bit more complicated than I suggested. That's character sets. After that, we have the browse. Talking I really care about is if my stick at the one other street layer and the post-it on something together. That's the big thing to me. We have post-it systems, that's my stick. Other countries have similar post-it systems. In the United States, for example, they have a zip-code system, and then zip plus four. You can get a post-it in that way as well. Jeff, what is that strange system? Yes. There's a city in the US called Color, which doesn't really do posts. You can send a post there, and you don't send it to a house. You go to collect it in the post office. It's quite bad there in the 1920s. In fact, no, I haven't posted it in the 1920s. Can you imagine moving to a post office to get your mail? This is the big problem. You can't know what it is. You can address something to Carl, you can't address something to a given part of Carl that a person wants to write to you. Sending a package, I mean, can you imagine life without Amazon? Receiving packages in there. You can't do that in Carl. But I'm fairly sure people in Carl are still more of Amazon. They just have to go to the post office to be done. How to deal with that? Well, let's say people can just put in the address of the system and their name. Okay, so if I'm mandating a postcode with a zip code, that will help. Same thing, in a lot of Middle Eastern countries, they don't have postcode codes in the ship, which is confusing. So the answer is surprisingly simple. You give them a box. They put in whatever detail they need to put in to get the package to them, to get the information to them. They just put it in, leave them on text. They know how to get the answer. You may not know how to get the answer. That's the most common. That was easy. Okay, the last two things I'm going to talk about together, they're internationalization and globalization. Or, as you may know, the LTN and the RETN, actually. I'm going to talk about them together because they are similar concepts. In fact, most large companies put them together as globalization, or GLN. If you're not a native English speaker, or even if you are a native English speaker, but it's not your mother tongue, you want to be able to go to canonsbuffybeer.com, the premier hangout for bloggers, and you want to be able to read it in a native language. It doesn't seem unreasonable. The question is, how can we make that happen? And you've got to look at two types of translation. Translation is the first thing. You've got to look at translating the interface, and the best way to do that is by using modules such as IATN, IATN, to translate those pieces. And you can do that in your templates. You can make calls to that in your templates. You can translate individual strings. Ultimately, you're still going to have to get someone to translate the interface to be a great profile, but that's probably difficult. That's not good. So, when it comes to the interface, you can just translate the data. And there are handy modules. The IATN one is a module. Unfortunately, when you've got 5.10, you've got this cool feature called Smart Match. This uses tilde tilde in the module in order to provide translations. So there are modules. It's based on one of the local get text modules, which provides a programmatic interface for accessing data. Highly recommend if you're using the modules. Some of them are really cool. There are local vision modules in core. There are translation modules
they would be uploaded to us. The second thing is data translation. If this is basically all we use on the website, you just create multiple columns. That's the simple way around it. If this is data your users are generating on the website, you give up, really. You can't translate them, you can't. You can fall back to Google Translate if you really want to. The data is still in the ground. Just give up. It's can't do it. And that's why most of the sites go to the right. Users can do it. And they will upload it wherever they want to upload in the native language. Not everyone can read Chromium's native language, but you can't make it better. That's translation. Next question. Formatting. Yeah, I can see you smiling back there, Johnny. Johnny is the only person I know in the world who, when quoting things, uses the little double arrow quotes. Does it all the time. That's a formatting thing. When quoting text, Johnny likes to use those little quotes, which I can't find in my people, so I'm not using them. Whereas I like to quote things in double quotes. I don't know, is that a standard thing as well?
Then, you have to distinguish between when I quote code, I want to distinguish my quote from the language quote.
Right, okay. Okay, fair enough. Makes sense. There are other types of formatting you should be thinking about. Numbers. When indicating decimals, in the UK, we use points. In other countries, they use commas. And when we're dealing with large numbers, we often put commas in to separate them and then end with points. This confuses people from other countries because they use commas for delimiting decimal separators, which is confusing. There are models to help out with this as well. If you know the source language, the person expects to interact with, make a better guess as to how you should perform as well, and you don't data. You format things like text. It's typical to think that everybody writes like you, that everyone puts pen to paper or more likely things to people, and they just write. And it goes from left to right, and then they get it. It goes on to the next slide, left to right. But we know that not everyone does that. We know that there are right to left languages. We know there are up to down right to left languages. We know there are down to up left to right languages. There are a large number of combinations. But in the world of the web, we care about left to right and right to left languages. And it's confusing. Hebrew is a right-to-left language. Urdu is a right-to-left language. Arabic is a right-to-left language. And this type of thing, and we're not thinking about the fact that it should be displayed right-to-left. People expect to see things in the right order, because if you're used to reading left-to-right, and I typed everything in reverse order, that's going to confuse you. And in HTML, there are several ways of achieving this, but the best one is you have the dir attribute to any tag, and the dir equals RTL, it'll render it in right to left fashion, which is best not done with English text, you can't read backwards. In languages where they are expected to be the breadth, right to left, you should take the count of that phrase. Users won't do it for you. If they're entering text in Arabic, they're not going to put the text in to deal with that. And at the minute, I researched this yesterday, there are no modules on the CPAN automatically doing this. It's hard.
work with that. Right to left text, just be aware that that's something you have to take account of. And particularly if you want to expand it in China, then you are going to run across it because China do quite like to left. On paper, they write bottom to top, right to left. But in the future world, apparently it's just right to left, which is not confusing at all. That's so important. I am not looking at that time. Okay, so we've got a station. Okay. I'm gonna give up. I realise that there's a lot of information, so let's have some time for questions, because I think we've got my goal to solve. The slides will be going up later.
Happening on the left, yeah. Content on the right, I think. I think regarding one of the one girl sites, which is advertising on the narrative articles, I think has recently gone through a redesign with using that the option. But yeah, they do now have a few much problems with when you found this site, then you started where it's left, and then the content just
uses the site. It being replacing some scroll bars, because you want the default position to be the scroll bar.
And browsers are now more aware that they're not written by American corporations. That is something that they don't have for you to see. Like, so, it's also available for the matters in the internet. But now, it gets to the state you can assume, talking about 1896, where that you can assume that most of your audience will have a browser that does that, and you can assume that a browser doesn't support it, will be just with being wrong.
Buzzwords and other things are important, which is stop trying to implement scroll bars and JavaScript. Because the native browser controls, people are used to them, their operating system or browser might even the way you expect to see them.
And even if I'm installing a rich topic, there's so much you can install them as well.
Exactly, and there's nothing more annoying than people asking for your store laws. As for right to left stuff, the thing is, I only first used this yesterday. Yesterday morning, I had a couple of words to my site, and I pasted in some Arabic for the introduction slide to internationalization. And I've never seen what right and left input looks like before, because I've just never got it. This is in SIS. And literally, got the text here, and there's an Arabic here. What is here? And when you type, it comes out here. But it's going forwards, and there's a separate slash, very thin cursor at the other side, where if you type in English, because it's confusing as hell. And slightly unknowing the first time you do that, it's strange. In my slides as well, the first thing I said about translation of the site is the naive way is to create several template trees. If you really want a special right to left site, that's it.